गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देव महेश्वरः गुरु साक्षात् परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। वी आर इन अमृत अनुभव चैप्टर 11, चैप्टर 11 इज इट, 11 ओवी नंबर 10। चैप्टर 11 और चैप्टर 10 Chapter 10 and OV number 10. What is Jivan Mukta Purusha? Lakshana we saw in the last chapter. Now, what is the conclusion of this Amrut Anubhav that we are looking at? And here he says, जनाते जने देखता दृष्टाचि दृश्य तत्वता कोण ही न होनी आयिता सिद्धांतः। When a person sees another person and vice versa, there is only the seer and nothing like the seen. Thus, the non-dual consciousness is already established so easily and effortlessly. It says, when a person sees another and vice versa, from the essence point of view, the person is both a drashta and drishya simultaneously. In fact, there is only a seer and nothing like seen. Thus, the non-dual consciousness is already established easily and effortlessly. Just like when we go into the dream, the mind itself becomes the dreamer and mind itself becomes the dream world. And when you wake up, you know both were illusions. A reality you are. And therefore you discard both of them. Exactly same way is in the waking state also. Exactly the same way your reality is that you are the eternal seer. So don't divide yourself into knower and known, seer and seen, experiencer and experienced. All that is included. When we look at the ocean, we look at only the waves. But the ocean is all waves put together. It is one. It has not become many. It can never become many. It's always been one. In this way, the non-dual consciousness is already established, meaning there is no chance that this consciousness can ever become two. It can never become the seer and the seen, or the knower and the known, or the experiencer and the experienced. It can never. And yet it appears to be so, isn't it? So what is, and what is appearance? How do you define appearance? That which comes and goes, which changes. But who knows the change? That is the one we are talking about here. So, not individual, the pure consciousness. Individual comes and goes because he is only present for this life, individual. We are not talking about individual. So, catch yourself about that, that you are that permanent principle. You are that eternal seer. There is nothing in this life that has happened which is not known to you. Childhood is known to you. Teenage is known to you. Middle age is known to you. Every year that passes by is known to you. That you are seeing, hearing, touching, feeling, tasting. Everything is known to you, isn't it? Even the thoughts that are taking place in the mind are also known to you. Isn't it? But then what happens? On account of those thoughts, you become the thinker. You give yourself a position. You give yourself a definition that I am a thinker. With respect to names and forms, I am the seer. With respect to sound, I am the hearer. With respect to smell, I am the smeller. With respect to taste, I am the taster. So based upon the objects experienced, you take a particular role. But when I'm talking to you about like this, at this moment, don't you know that the role, the seer and the seen were there? Now you are hearing, so hearer and the heard are there. After that, suddenly you want to feel the sofa, the feeler and the felt is there. So they are also coming and going continuously. Who knows this? You only know it. Who knows yesterday? Now take a larger picture. Who knows the waker and the waking world, the dreamer and the dream world, and the deep sleeper and the deep sleep world? Who knows that these come and go every day? You only know, isn't it? That one who knows that these come and go every day is the eternal seer, is the actual one, is the pure consciousness. So keep coming back to that original position. Don't take a relative position. Relative position is, right now, considering yourself to be individual, right now considering yourself to be a seeker, right now considering yourself to be a not knower. No. Let this all continue, but don't shortchange yourself. Take the original position. As every chapter in the Gita concludes with the words Om Tat Sat Iti, the Amrita Anubhava uses the term Siddha Anubhava, the already established, asserted, and already known experience of one's own being. Siddha Anubhava, the experience that which already is already attained. Vedanta also says the same thing, that you are the eternal truth. You don't have to attain it. You have to just be it. One without a second disposition is the natural disposition. After that, the duality begins. And duality is only an imagination of the mind. The already established, asserted, and already known experience of one's own being that is being talked of, it is not something new. Therefore, the truth is already established without effort. So when we take this position that you are the knower of all the three, waker, dream and deep sleep, and these three states, do you have to do anything? You have to only be that. You have to bring that thought, isn't it? And even that thought that you are bringing is known to you. See, so again and again, coming to the eternal principle, the essence, the unchanging principle, and thinking takes you away from it. Thinking takes you away from that original position. See? The Amrit Anubhav, what does the word Amrit Anubhav mean? Amrit is the nectar, Anubhav is the experience. Experience of the nectar of being. See? And that being is not a relative being, he is the absolute. By presenting Amrit Anubhav, Sant Jnaneshwara disclaims any greatness because what he said is what has ever been existing. So there is nothing new created. If a scientist says that I discovered gravity. Big deal. Gravity was already there. In the 70s, in the stupid Europeans, I am purposely using this word, they discovered Earth is round. When? In the 15th or 16th century. Earth was already round. They didn't discover it. They were ignorant about it. Isn't it? The present the scientists, they are saying, oh, there are positive quarks. Then they found, first they found quarks, some material in the space. That is what the space is made up of, because they are so objectively looking for answers. Then they realized, oh, there are positive quarks and negative quarks, quarks. Did they discover it, or it was already there? It was already there. Now the probe which America sent, it went to Jupiter, it has gone all the way to Saturn, and it is going further. And when it is taking photographs of the universe, they are seeing new constellations. They are seeing bodies which they had not seen before. Oh, this is a new one. New one? It was already there. You didn't see it. See? So there is nothing that the scriptures or your seeking can bring about which is not already there. So here they are saying the self is already there. In its presence, all activity is going on. In its presence, the activity at manasa vacha kaya, activity at mind, speech and body level, it is going on. In its presence. In its presence, the whole universe is functioning. But what happens is we forget our position and we come down and become conditioned by time, space and objectivity. What is this principle? It is independent, it is transcendental to the time, space and objectivity. It is not slave of time, space, objectivity. It cannot be limited by time, space and objectivity. It cannot be limited by positions and relations. Cannot be, it is limitless, unconditioned. And that's what you are, Amrit Anubhav is telling us. By pursuing the spiritual path, one is not doing anything extraordinary. One is just naturally moving towards one's own source. Just as the cow returns home after days grazing and long to be tethered, so also do our sense organs roam over life, grazing the sense experiences, but find fulfillment only when they are withdrawn and get absorbed in their own source, called the pure, unmanifest, blissful, conscious existence that I is. This itch to be completely at rest within our bosom, it will continuously be there till we don't get established in the self. Who does not get established in the self? The mind. It's the mind which has the itch. Mind is extroverted. You are the eternal watcher, isn't it? But right now, even though I have reminded you, and the text is reminding us that we are the eternal watcher, are we remaining in that position all the time? Very quickly we slip down, isn't it? Very quickly the moment you said yes, you have already slipped. Because you are identifying with the words. You are not remaining a observer of the words. You are not remaining aloof from the words that are coming to you. So a response. And therefore, the Dakshinamurti Stotram says, Maunam Vyakhyat, means silence is remain in silence. Truth is revealed only in silence. No response. So at a temporary level, at a on a daily level, whole day, now the morning has come, our mind has started going out into the world. We have a belief, we have it's become like clockwork. Every Sunday we start the day with a satsang, come, go home, however the day unfolds. In fact, every day begins like this. Something, you start off in the morning, mind was absolutely calm, it gets filled up with all the activity during the day. And when the evening comes, again the activity starts diminishing. And eventually, where does the mind find peace and tranquility? Only in sleep, isn't it? But if you observe this pattern throughout your life, every day this is going on. You haven't found eternal peace. It is temporary peace and bliss, which sleep provides, isn't it? So, why did mind become extrovert? Only to become introvert. It's a habit that the world is going to give me peace and tranquility. But actually you are getting is in deep sleep, relatively speaking. So what is deep sleep? No thoughts. What is waking or dream? So many thoughts. So many thoughts are not giving you the satisfaction of peace and tranquility. Only sleep is getting you. But that sleep is also temporary. Because every day it comes, every day it goes. If this is the data that you have, then won't it be an intelligent proposition for us to pursue something by which our mind can be empty like in deep sleep, even while we are waking? Isn't it? 24/7, if our mind is calm and peaceful like in deep sleep, that will be the best way. But still, out of habit, we don't pursue that. We continue to pursue the world, thinking that more activity, more interaction, more arguments, more data, more WhatsApp, more this, all that will make us complete. It will make us acceptable. All this is very, very important. I have to respond to every SMS that comes, every WhatsApp that comes, every email that comes. This is our disposition, and we then lose the plot. And suddenly stress, strain, irritation, agitation, all this becomes our norm. So here Jnaneshwar Maharaj is telling us, don't go in that direction. Recognize you are the eternal one and the peace and tranquility is your nature. And look at the data that is available in your one day. Where do you get the most peace and tranquility? Only when mind is zero. So the question should continue to prick us is in the mind. How can I make this mind permanently into zero? Isn't it? How does it become zero? Two ways. Die. Or three ways. Go into coma. But we don't know. Maybe in coma it still goes on. But the other way, the intelligent way would be, let the mind realize that it is none other than the consciousness. Isn't it? If the wave realizes that it is the infinite waters, the fear of death goes away completely. Same way, if this individual consciousness, which is an aspect of the mind alone, if it comes to realize that it is the infinite one, the eternal one, not the one who is coming and going on a daily basis as waker, dreamer, deep sleeper, or as this particular individual in this particular life, then everything will be fantastic. It will be eternally happy then. But no, we are like that dog's tail. Want to continue to become complete by more activity, increased activity. It is not by respiration that one is alive, nor by taking food, nor by taking medicines do I remain healthy, but it is because I am alive that I respire. Because I am alive, I eat food. That there is a possibility of disease, treatment and good health, etc. also because I am alive. It's not the other way around. Because day and night is there, therefore there must be sun, you know. No, because sun is there, therefore day and night are there. See, we created these walls and we got the space to live. No, space was there, therefore you created the walls. It's the other way. So, what is this life? Be curious about it. We are curious about the objects. Human beings are also, we take it under the objects only, living objects. We are continuously wanting to interact with this. No, interact with life. What is this life? What is making me alive? What is this consciousness? Until unless this doesn't click inside, till then happiness is far away, even though it is your nature. Because only by coming to the source, you will be happy. So be that source. Don't shortchange yourself by becoming a temporary one who is coming and going continuously. As an individual on a larger scale, or on a daily scale, waker, dreamer and deep sleeper. Or further degradation, in the daytime, only in the waking, the father, the mother, the daughter, the sister, again we are breaking ourselves up. So do we not play those roles? Let the roles be played. You don't forget who you are. Maintain that position, that these are only the roles. This I, which this was given in the Katha Upanishad, this I which is giving existence to every pair of opposites cannot be influenced by them. Once this vision is of looking at the relative through the glasses of absolute is developed, then one will have glimpses of what Sant Jnaneshwar Maharaj is telling us, that there is nothing to be established. It already is. It is not a hypothesis. It is not a theory. It is the truth. So right now, what is our position? Through the individual glasses, we are trying to search for the infinite. Isn't it? Through the individual glasses, we are searching for the finite. Through the waker, we are trying to work out the transcendental principle. Through the waker. As long as you remain through the body, we want to come to know. Through the mind, we want to come to know. But all these are only, limited factors. When we studied Bhagavad Gita with Swamiji, the first sentence he said was, you want to understand Bhagavad Gita, don't take the position of Arjuna. You'll remain ignorant even in the end. He remained ignorant. Okay, his doubts were cleared, but only temporarily. Then what to do? He said, take the position of our Krishna. Wear his shoes and start thinking from what position he is, what disposition he is, that he has such a clarity of thought of presenting the entire Bhagavad Gita. The whole scheme is crystal clear in his mind. Therefore, he can present it, isn't it? Why didn't he give the 13th chapter in the second chapter and second chapter in the fifth chapter and the fifth chapter in the ninth chapter? No. It's perfect unfoldment. Perfect unfoldment. When you are teaching a child, you already know the information. And you try to, because you are absolutely clear of the information that you have to give to the child when the child asks that, mummy, why 2 plus 2 is equal to 4 or 3 plus 3 is equal to, and you laugh, he's counting like this. And he makes the mistake. And you take the chocolates or you take the apples. See, one apple plus one apple is equal to two apples. For him, it is such a fantastic discovery that I can count, I can multiply. But for you, it's no big deal, isn't it? Just like that. Krishna, for Krishna to unfold the scheme of life, unfoldment in Bhagavad Gita, it's no big deal. Because he's the absolute. He's taking the position of the absolute. So if we want to change the game of life, rather than continuing to impress on our mind that we are individual, we are seekers, we are not knowing the truth, we are at the mercy of the world, with the government and the people, and my body identification is not going, the mind is going crazy, it is not listening to me, and blah, and the senses are thinking, seeing this and hearing that, and instead of complaining in this manner, see, the fact that you are saying these things, that the eyes are seeing and the ears are, you know that they are doing their job. Only then you can make that statement, isn't it? Take the position of the absolute. First thing that will happen if you take the position of unwanted discussion and interaction will stop. And over a period of time, the mind will also start settling down. It will not want to think only. It will not want to think. But again, you have a problem, or common man has a problem. If I am not thinking, I am having dementia. Don't go into that direction. Calm mind, zero mind is a healthy mind. It is not a problematic mind. See? So, all these wrong notions that we have about yourself, let them all be swallowed up into the self. Take that position. Everything will start coming down in the mind. Once this vision of looking at the relative through the glasses of the absolute. So right now what we are doing, through the glasses of the relative, we are trying to look for the absolute. Never possible. Never possible. You can attempt life after life after life, day in and day out. Through the relative, you can never find the absolute. Then what can we do? When will the unfoldment take place? When will the abidance happen? The day you stop all this. This day you stop seeking through the relative. The day you stop it. Actually, sir, before I came to Vedanta class, I was not seeking only. I was okay. So I studied all this for last 10, 15, 20 years, and now you are telling me, give it all up, stop seeking. I am already that. Why couldn't you tell me this before? I had to study so much, then come to know that I am already that. We said that that time also. That time you didn't listen. So 20 years of studies. See, you can go to sleep few ways. You can go to sleep as a result of living your day fully and exhausting yourself, right? You go to the bed, bang, you're gone, isn't it? Another way, you can have liquid spirituality and somehow totter to the bed and go down. Right? That is another way. Another way is, before going to bed, time has come, you're contemplating, you're meditating and doing your japa, remembering the mysteries of life, and in that contemplation somewhere the sleep comes and you go to sleep. Another fourth way is conscious sleep. Yeah, that is what they call as yoga nidra. So your mind is sleeping and you are conscious. Now, which one will be the healthier one? When you have worked hard throughout the day and gone to sleep, bang, like a stone, you are gone. Next morning, you are fresh. Or the body may be tired, but your mind is fresh. You go to sleep with a intoxication, next morning you'll get up with a massive headache. Third was, you contemplate on the truth or mysteries of the world, of life. You go to sleep, next morning when you get up, you'll wake up thinking of those mysteries only. And the last one, you contemplate on the truth. No, yoga nidra we said, no? So you're conscious of the sleep coming. That is yoga nidra. And what is conscious? You're being conscious of the sleep coming. You're conscious of mind becoming zero in yoga nidra. And you're conscious of mind becoming active again. See? So all this was possible when? Only in the relative all this is possible, isn't it? So how you program your mind, and do you want the mystical experience? Do you want the tired experience? Do you want the intoxicated experience? Do you want the conscious sleep? All that has to be practiced in the relative only. So, in the relative, we are telling you that you are actually the absolute. You are imagining yourself to be the not absolute, imagining yourself to be the relative. So, stop taking yourself to be less than what you actually are. Stop considering yourself to be less than what you actually are. You are the absolute, not the relative, not the one who is going to come and go, not the one who was born and going to die. Then one will have a glimpse of what Jnaneshwar Maharaj is telling. And what is he telling? That you are what you are seeking, you are already that. The truth is not an unknowable. Truth or the self that we are, that absolute consciousness that we are, it is not an unknowable, it is not a theory, it is not a concept. We are talking in concepts, but it is not a concept. It is your direct, it is who you essentially are. Thinking is concept, body is a concept, convictions are a concept, world is a concept. Past and future are a concept. Mind is a concept. But truth is not a concept. Consciousness is not a concept. You are that. Once this is known, there is nothing further to be known. Yaya parite kahi samvidrahasya nahi ani hetaya adhihi asatachi ase. Beyond this, there is no secret about the non-dual consciousness. This is as it is, even before and after the duality is experienced. Swamiji says, beyond this, that is what has been presented in Amrit Anubhav, nothing more remains to be known about the pure, undivided, conscious, blissful existence. Adi Shankaracharya in Sadachar, verse 5 says, the total manifestation is the sport of the two aspects of the same truth, the knowledge aspect and the non-knowledge aspect, the subject and the object, the seer and the seen. So, this absolute self itself has become the waker and the waking world, the dreamer and the dream world, the sleeper and the sleep world, and the game is going on. You don't get caught up in the game. If you get caught up in the game, then someone has to take you out of the game. Just like if you are caught up in a maze, someone has to help you to come out of the maze. Like yesterday, one small kid, she was eating food. Mummy, I can't finish this, I can't finish that. Then mom has to help to finish the food. When you're doing your homework as a child and you get stuck somewhere in the spelling or in the exercise, then parents have to explain, or the elder brother or sister have to explain to get you out of that difficulty that you have caught yourself in. Exactly the same way. If we think ourselves of anything less as a relative, as a conditioned entity, then someone needs to come into your life. The God needs to come into your life. He needs to send someone into your life. A guru must come into your life. The scriptures will come into your life in order to wake you up. Because in the end, everyone is wanting to wake up to their own essential nature. Everyone is looking for peace and tranquility. When you are satisfying your desires in the outside world, it is not for the sake of the object, it is for the sake of your desire. Once the desire is satisfied, the mind becomes calm, it becomes happy, it becomes unagitated. And when that is experienced, it says, this is a good way to experience peace and tranquility. So it thinks of another desire. And again we try to satisfy it, and when it gets satisfied, again our mind becomes calm. But that is the wrong way of going in life. Here Nanashwar Maharaj is saying, being the self, being the undivided consciousness, this pure consciousness itself becomes the subject and object, seer and the seen, the waker and the waking world, dreamer and the dream world, deep sleeper and the deep sleep world. All duality is not separate to the consciousness. It is imagined on the consciousness. Just like all the waves are imagined on the waters, exactly the same way, all duality is imagined on the infinite consciousness. And that infinite consciousness you are. And all the duality also you know. Isn't it? Otherwise, how can you talk about it? The same truth expresses at one point as the subject and resides at the other point as the object. This is not very difficult. It sounds out of this world. But in the dream, mind alone became the subject and mind alone became the object. So, was there someone else in the mind? We may use that type of language, I had a dream and this person came into the mind, this lion came in the mind and it was attacking me. But your mind alone was the you, and your mind alone became the lion, and your mind alone became the attacking also, and you are afraid of yourself. because you identified only with one person, one body, one instrument in the dream and called it, that's what I am, and rest, everything is separate to me. But if you look at it from, once you wake up, then you realize, hey, everything was my mind only. Immediately the fear of lion goes away. Immediately all the attachments and all the relationships and all the positions and all the roles that you are playing in the dream, everything becomes null and void, isn't it? The moment you wake up. So is true when you wake up in the waking plane to your essential nature. All the positions, relations, interactions, limitations, conditions, everything will become null and void. You will not get affected by anything. When this apparent difference of the subject being conscious and the object being inert is totally removed, where the subject-object become one, there the Sambhit Rahasya, the supreme secret about the truth, is revealed instantaneously in the form of reasonless, abundant love for everything and every being. As long as the duality continues, sense of separation will bring about fear. The sense of separation will bring about, what can I gain from that person? Sense of separation will bring about judgment, biasness. It will bring about compassion, it will bring about pity, it will bring about empathy. All this is for someone else, isn't it? Anger, greed, jealousy, etc., etc., all that happens where there is duality, where there is sense of otherness. But where there is oneness, whom will you show compassion to? Whom will you show empathy to? Whom will you get angry about with? There's no one to get angry. There's no one to get angry. There's no one to get jealous with. There's nothing to desire because there's no other. And therefore, the exercise that is given, that this apparent duality of subject and object, when they merge into one, when the object, subject, how does the subject and object merge into one? When the distance between the two becomes lesser and lesser. How does it become lesser and lesser? You have to recognize that you are not the subject. You are not that subject in opposition to object. But you are that eternal subject who is watching the subject-object game going on. Then the distance becomes less. And when that happens, the truth is revealed instantaneously. And this is all, what we are just talking about, is all happening in the mind, because the mind is keeping us in the loop of individuality. This thinking has to stop. When there is no identity between the subject and the object, there is no love. Where there is considerable identity, as in the case of near and dear ones, there also love is, but it is conditional. Love ceases when the condition is not met. It is relative love. Thirdly, when the identity is complete, as with the gross body in the waking state, the love is total. Wherever the knower known difference becomes zero, the love is natural. Wherever the knower known difference becomes zero, then unconditional love starts expressing. It's not because of, not due to, not on account of. There are no conditionings then. There's no reason. It's reasonless, causeless love. Because that is your nature. This is what happens when a desire is satisfied. This is the Atma Rahasya of Sambhit or Sambhit Rahasya or Jivan Mukti. This is the secret of manifestation of unconditional love for everything and every being in the whole universe. At every moment, without effort, this unconditional love is not a created one. Your love towards your husband or wife or children is a created love. Do you feel that love for the for your child or grandchild? Do you feel the same love for all the children that age? No. So it is created love. It is conditional. Get out of it. Make an attempt to love all children the same way as you do with your. See? So what the unconditional love that we are talking about, it is not limited to only children. It is the natural expression of the absolute self. And how does it express? Many times we have said, accepting everything, rejecting nothing, but retaining nothing. Accepting everything in this world, rejecting nothing in this world, and retaining nothing in this world. This is only possible when you are beyond the world. If you consider yourself to be a part and parcel of this world, this disposition is not possible. In other words, accepting everything, rejecting nothing, retaining nothing means nothing is going on. It's leela, it's game. This is the secret of manifestation of unconditional love for everything and every being in the whole universe at every moment without effort. Anything less than this means a fall from the absolute abode to the relative tragedy. And that is why masters, saints and sages, they are ever in bliss. They don't have opinion about anything. They don't comment about anything. They don't insist on anything in life. Theek hai, everything is okay, you know. There's no agenda in their life. Nothing to improve in this life. Nothing to disprove in this life. Yesterday I was seeing one of the so-called masters, and he's a devotee of Babaji, and he says, he has sent me to improve the world, to bring more happiness to the world. And they use all good language, you know, all the flowery language. But the fact that you have an agenda, that you want to improve the world, that you want to improve the world, means what? You have already taken the world to be a reality. Isn't it? What can be done to improve this world? The Lord has created this world. He knows how to handle it. He knows how to handle it. He knows what each person is going through. What that person needs. See? But if it is your desire to improve the world, and that desire you are giving it to the Lord, that Lord chose me, my Baba chose me, my this one chose me, and he told me that go and do this. I don't understand it. It's like when I was called for a meeting, and as a speaker, and they said, and they wanted to raise some money and get a grant from the government to help certain section of the society. So my question to them was, if the government doesn't give you the money, will you still continue with this project? Or is this project dependent on the receiving of money from the government, out of which 10% you will use for the project, rest of it you pocket? Because the amount was $250,000. See, a person who wants to do something, he will not wait for anything. He will continue. If it comes, that will be bonus, isn't it? Other than this, there is nothing to be known. This love cannot be total if the world is taken to be a mithya. Meaning what? If you take this world to be mithya. Mithya means what? Illusion. If you take world to be illusion, you will never love the world. Isn't it? And if you take the world to be illusion, then you have illusion versus truth. Then how can truth be all-inclusive? How can unconditional love flow towards the world? Oh, I cannot love you because you are temporary. Isn't it? Today's meditation was this. Today's meditation was, our disposition should be such that the full establishment in the truth means this world is an expression of the divine, and that divine is expressing as the self within my bosom, in my heart. The world is not other than the divine, and that divine is expressing as the self in my heart. So the self and the world do not become separate. There is no distance created between them. This will be the complete realization that everything is one. What is that one? The divine. What is that one? The unconditioned bliss. What is that divine? It is the grace. Absolutely. See, now what is, see, what, did you listen to her question? Is the mind divine too? Don't stop there. Is the body divine also? Are the thoughts divine also? Or is my anger, greed, jealousy, love, compassion, empathy, positive and negative thoughts and emotions and convictions and notions, are they divine too? Are good people and bad people, are they divine too? Why only stop there? Then what you mean, all this killing that is taking place in the world, that is also divine. All the births that are taking place, all the good people that are being troubled by the bad people, that is also divine. Then what do you say? If we say, yeah, it is true, but how do you process it in yourself? How do you process it? Yes, it is all Leela. That's one way of processing it. But this is where the all-inclusivity comes. Accepting everything, rejecting nothing. Think, we are having so many words to explain what we just now did because we feel we are an individual, isn't it? Let's take the position of the wave. as a way we are thinking, you know, I have to do this, I have to do that, or I have to accept every all other ways, I have to accept all the oceans, I have to accept all the gods, ocean meaning God, all other ways meaning all other individuals and objects. I have to accept everything, reject nothing, retain nothing. Now take a position of the water, the absolute. What will be the water's disposition? From water's point of view, is there any ocean or wave? No. So what will it accept? What will it reject? What will it not retain? So from absolute standpoint, whatever we are seeking, it's already concluded there, isn't it? Because we have something called a mind, a thinking process, so we are saying accept everything, reject nothing, retain nothing. This is through the words. But what is it leading to? Absolute is doing exactly the same thing without saying anything. Because it alone is. For us, duality is still there. For absolute, unity is only there. And that unity also, it doesn't say that it's all, it's unity, because there is nothing else other than it. Isn't it? From water's point of view, we're saying. From sun's point of view, there is no duality of day and night. No duality. It alone is. From water's point of view, there is no duality. Ocean and wave don't exist. Wave versus wave don't exist. So, all this language is only for the mind. From the absolute, nothing matters. Because it's one without a second. There is nothing for it to convince. Because it doesn't have, absolute doesn't have a mind. It's complete. Mind only comes where there is incompleteness. Incompleteness means duality. Where duality comes, mind comes. Mind itself is an expression of incompleteness from our point of view. Right? But what Jnaneshwar Maharaj is saying, if you take the position of the absolute, if rather than continuing to think that mind is incomplete, mind is a product that it has got good thoughts and bad thoughts, rather than going into all this, start thinking that everything is an expression of that divine alone. Then where is our attention? When you ask the question, your attention is on the mind. Where is the attention being asked to go to? To the divinity. So when your attention is on the, see, for example, this is the problem that all seekers also have. When we are said, told, contemplate, put attention on the mind. Where do we put the attention? On the thoughts. But instruction was put the attention on the mind. Instruction was not put attention on the thoughts. But by default, we start thinking about the thoughts. We put attention on the thoughts. Then what is mind? Mind is that space, that substratum, that foundation on which the thoughts are coming and going, isn't it? We miss the point. See? Like that. Here also, we miss the point. Exactly the same way. Here, a classic example is taken. One cannot love an illusion, the snake on the rope or the shadow, just like you can never love the snake, because immediately fear will come in. You cannot love the illusion, meaning you cannot love the duality, because where there is duality, fear automatically comes in. Fear of being used, fear of being manipulated, fear of death, fear of whatever. fear of losing the your existence. So to take you out of this fear, to take you out of this fear, these thoughts are there. Truth is equal to fearlessness. And fear is only on account of one thing, fear of being. Fear comes because we have chosen to be identified with only one body. The moment we identify with only one body, individuality comes about. And who are we essentially? Infinite. So the infinite waters have decided, for whatever reason, to identify with only one form, that is called wave. From that very moment, misery begins. And what is that water in the wave? Essentially, the infinite waters. So exactly the same way, we are also that infinite. Allow the game to go on. And don't run away from anything in this world. Don't run away. Instead, redefine it. Instead of saying world is bad, mind is bad, mind has to be annihilated, waking dream, deep sleeper, you know, they are keeping me in the loop, I have to get out of this. No, you can't run away from anything in this world. What you can do is divinize the whole world. You can run away for some time, go into Nirvikalpa Samadhi, but when you come out, the world is still there. You can go away, run away from this world, go to sleep, but when you wake up again, the world is there. Then how can I find a lasting solution? It is only by redefining the whole world, that this entire world is nothing but a play of the divine. Divine himself is the whole world. Divine himself is the self. And once you take that position, then you are contemplating on the divine. You are not contemplating on the world. Your question came because your attention was on the mind. Your attention was not on the divine. Because putting attention on the divine will take away all the questions from the mind. And not divine as a concept, not divine as a statue there. Divine as the consciousness, divine as the life force, divine as that which is all-inclusive. What does all-inclusive mean? Your mind can never work it out. But you have to present it with such thoughts that it tries and tries and tries and tries and eventually gives up. Then you will be in your natural state. Further, the Amrut Anubhav, one cannot love an illusion, the snake on the rope or the shadow. Therefore, Jnaneshwar Maharaj tells us to drop this world is a mithya concept totally and see everything in the world, whether seen or not seen, as Paramatma alone. So, with compared to examples, we can understand. Day and night cannot be without the sun. Whether it is the statue of Ram or Krishna, or it is the statue of Ravana or Kumbhakarna, it is gold alone. Whether it is a tsunami or a gentle wave, it is water alone. We can understand. Whether you are a waker, dreamer or deep sleeper with the respective world, you are the one. Yes, I understand this. So rather than taking the dream, waking and deep sleep to be something of a problem, something to be discarded, something to be worked out, Jnaneshwar, this is very high. You can, this is PhD, beyond PhD. Instead of taking that position to be something to be discarded, something to be annihilated, something to be neutralized, instead what do? Divinize the whole thing. And how do you divinize? By putting your attention on the divinity, seeing that everything is an expression of the divine alone. You'll try to annihilate only that. In duality, you always want to run away from something. You always want to control something. You always want to let go of something, isn't it, in duality? But what is the definition of unity or the absolute? All-inclusiveness. There's nothing outside of it. So what are you going to let go, grow out of, annihilate, subdue, sublimate? Nothing to. Leave the mind alone. Don't get caught up in it. It catches you by making you think. And you think that you are thinking. You think you are thinking. Mind is thinking of its own accord. Right now, if I ask you, all the thoughts that have gone through your mind just now, right at this moment, do you know that the thinking is going on? Yes. So you are not, you are the observer, you are not the thinking person. Thinking is taking place. This is how matter functions. It at its own speed. Just like you are observing day and night coming and going, you are observing the waking dream, deep sleep coming and going. Exactly the same way, your position is that of being an observer in whose presence the thoughts are coming and going. Don't identify with them. Don't take ownership. Further, this Amrut Anubhava of non-dual consciousness has always been present. It has not appeared because I have said so in this text. It is an eternally present truth. It is as it is, before and after the duality is experienced. When the eyes see various objects, but the objects do not leave any impression of good or bad, important or unimportant on the mind, at that time the mind is just pure consciousness with the freedom to express or not to express the knowingness in the form of the Triputi. These triads can be absorbed at will into this pure consciousness that I am. How beautiful Swamiji has written. When the eyes see what is the difference between us and masters, we have a problem, or this is our disposition. Whenever we interact with the world, immediately seer seen seeing, hearer heard hearing, taster tasted tasting, knower known knowing, experiencer experienced experiencing, these triads are born. This is how knowledge is collected. Right now, satsang is going on. You are the hearer. You have taken that position. If I am not aware, speaker, spoken to and speaking. Triad. Hearer, heard, hearing, triad. And what does a realized master do? So I have taken a position. You have taken a position. What is that position? I am a speaker. I am a teacher. What have position you have taken? You are the hearer. You are the student. And how do masters move around in this world? Their eyes see, but no seer is born. They talk, but no talker is born. And while talking, if they stop, they don't feel bad. There's no doubt in their mind. Oh, what is, if I stop in the middle of the satsang, if I stop, what will other people think? They don't care. They don't care. That is what Swamiji is saying here. When the eyes see various objects, but the objects do not leave any impression of good or bad, important or unimportant on the mind, at that time, the mind is just pure consciousness. Now, this is the next point. With the freedom to express or not to express the knowingness in the form of Triputi. Do I need to express it? Ramana Maharishi never expressed it. In silence, he gave the knowledge. other people can't stop talking. Other masters can't stop talking. So each one is different. But because he is talking, he is not established in the self. No. Everyone is established in the self. Question is, are you taking that position or not? Are you being that or not? These triads can be absorbed at will into this pure consciousness that I am. Have you, how to absorb this triad? I'll give you an example. When a child is troubling you and wanting something, mummy, mummy, daddy, daddy, mummy, mummy, daddy, daddy, and you can observe that slowly, you are getting irritated and you know you are going to react, but at that point of reaction you change your thought in the mind and the reaction or the anger that is coming up, it gets absorbed back. You have absorbed the triad, you have absorbed the reaction, isn't it? When you wake up in the morning, open your eyes, oh my God, and you don't want to become the waker with respect to the waking world, what do? Go back. You go back. You have absorbed the triad, isn't it? When we are moving around in the world, many, many times, so many reactions bubble up inside. But we don't express every reaction that is coming up in the mind. So many of them, we absorb them, isn't it? You have absorbed the triad. So you also know how to. But a master is ever alert about it. We only know few of them to absorb with respect to the relative world. He is absorbing the entire relativity only. That is the only difference. And that is possible only when your attention is on the absolute or you are the absolute from that point. The seeker comes to see the world as the sport of the self manifested through the power of veiling and projection. When both veiling and projection are dropped, only the pure self remains. So says Sadachar. No event, no experience has the freedom to disturb us unless we make ourselves vulnerable. This is what we are just talking. Just now what we said, that we have absorbed so many reactions because it's not worth it. That's why we drink the poison, so to speak. Isn't it? Anger is coming, you drink it. Jealousy is coming, you drink it. Sometimes hunger is coming, and rather than getting disturbed by the hunger, you drink the hunger. That okay, when the lecture is over, then we can have the tea, coffee, you know. Isn't it? So you drink the disturbances, you drink the reactions, means you do not express them. They were about to show their hood, but you did not allow it. Means you have absorbed the triad. No event, no experience has the freedom to disturb us unless we make ourselves vulnerable. How do we make ourselves vulnerable? By giving value and attention to that which is creating the disturbance in our mind. Or to give value to that thought. Take ownership of that thought. Eyes are seeing, the form is presented to the eyes. But the mind has to come and say, ah, I know. This is Lewis. That is ownership. Immediately a knower is born, known is born, and the knowing is taking place. But if the eyes are open, forms are seen, but nobody is there to own it. Such a person is called a mad fellow. I am reading biography of this Chelappa, of this Yoga Swami. His teacher was Chelappa Swami, a lunatic, a mad fellow in Jaffna, in temple. He used to sit out there. He will abuse the hell out of people. He will, people also never take bath, never. People also going, they want to keep him away because some disease may come or he's just mad. If you say, how are you? He will abuse the hell out of you. He will not talk straight to anyone. And this master's biography whom I'm reading, he was going there one day and he looked at him. The mad fellow looked at him and he said, do you know who you are? Yoga Swami says, that day my life changed. So, behind the facade of lunacy, there was a realized master. But if he tells everyone, shows his true colors, people will trouble him. But that's how it expressed there. Who are we to decide anything? That's how it expressed there.
He spoke to him three times.
That's all.
Yes. First he asked, who are you? Then search yourself.
I have not reached there yet.
Then one more.
Okay. See? So instructions coming from a madman. The whole world condemns him. Whole world abhors him. They don't, they want to throw him out, don't want to be in his company. Yet, there is a wise man. It's only a facade. The waves are only the facade of the infinite waters. Only the top part. How deep is the ocean? How deep are the waters? How vast are the waters? You can never determine from the waves, isn't it? Exactly the same way. Don't live at the superficial level. Even in your personality, what is your superficial level? Only as body, breath, mind, intellect. That is your superficial level. You are much, much more vast and deeper than that. Come back to the original. Any event in the world is powerful not because it has the power, but because we are weaklings. We have given it the power by processing it in our mind that this person, this event, this situation is more powerful and I cannot handle it. It is very difficult. It is out of my scope. I don't have the resources to handle this. No. You are the infinite one. Don't shortchange yourself. Nothing is impossible. Let us discover the strength from within. Refuse to be influenced by the world. The sweetest way of such refusal is to accept and accept the total world as it is. This is how the world is. Stop reacting. Stop trying to improve it. Stop trying to judge it. Stop trying to annihilate it. Accept the world, don't reject the world, don't retain the world. This is the mantra. This is the mantra. Then you are ever in that conscious space. So understand, anything in this world becomes powerful only because you have given it the power. And how you have given it the power? By considering yourself to be lower. Isn't it? Now don't go and start practicing this on your husband. No. Only by considering yourself to be lower, you have given the power to other to be higher or greater. The day you consider, in spite, you may not understand it completely. But because scriptures are saying, because masters are saying, because they have great masters have got established in it, then it must be true. take yourself to be the infinite principle. And when you take that, every moment you are expanding. Nothing is impossible for you. You are looking for ways and means to be that. Then if you are washing dishes, every day you wash dishes. But how can I wash that dish more perfectly every time I touch a dish? That becomes the perfection. It's not obsessive, but automatically you move in that direction. See, when you are walking all the time, but how can I walk with awareness every moment without any slip? That becomes the game. I'm talking so many satsangs. How can I surrender myself so that no thought is expressed because of my will, but it happens as the will of the divine? That becomes the game. You don't become the speaker. Similarly, don't become the hearer. I understood, I didn't understand. No, get out of the way. Allow knowledge to take place. That knowledge is not this word knowledge. This word knowledge is only prompting the mind to realize that it is the infinite one. And in this way, therefore, one should not be perturbed by every small little event in life, but accept them as rockets fired at the correct time to keep the space object of our life on the proper path. Paramatma is guiding us through every experience. Constant practice, abhyasa, to keep oneself close to our own essential nature will help us to take the sting out of the relative world. Let us therefore transcend the relative perception and come to the absolute abode of pure consciousness that anyway we are. That absolute consciousness you already are. But keep thinking about it again and again and again and again. See, now one girl came. She says, Swamiji, do you know anyone? I said, what do you mean? She says, no, I'm looking for boys. I'm not finding any right one. Do you know anyone? So where is her attention? She wants to get married. And in that, Swamiji, I only want twins. I don't want single. Please bless me there. See? So where is her attention? It's not on the consciousness. Her attention is on getting married. Her attention is on children. And it will take, her life will go in that direction because her attention is, all her eggs are in that basket of marriage and children, isn't it? Where are your eggs? Are they in the family? Are they in the grandchildren? Are they in the children? Are they in the world? Are how I am good and world is bad? How I am satsangi and other people don't go to satsang? I think they are lower than me. How your attention, how all your value giving is on being, on that this body is real. It's all value giving. Or is your attention always on the divine principle? In and through all your activities, that will make all the difference. That will give us the strength. That will give us the creativity. Because divine is ever creative. Look at the Leela, look at the creation, continuously expanding. Isn't it? It's not other than the divine. But do we have the vision? No. Because we are seeing objects. We are seeing space, objects and time. The divine is just is. It doesn't see space, object and time. I, the pure consciousness, is always present in the presence of the trio during the waking and dream states, and in their absence, in the deep sleep state, I am other than the known and the unknown. This I have already explained before. Known, waking and dream. Unknown, deep sleep state. You know these three states are continuously coming and going. You are the knower of these three. Take that position. Right now, what position have you taken? Of being the waker. So if you think in this waking state, you are being a seeker, you are being a student, After some time, you will be a driver. Then you will become a wife or a husband or a mother or whatever. Different roles, but these are roles only. That one waker alone is becoming so many different roles, isn't it? But take one step back. Who is that one who has become taken on the role of waker, dreamer and deep sleeper? That's also you only, isn't it? Be attentive about that one. Indent through all activities. That is what is being told here. This is told in Keno Upanishad. Therefore, this I, which is present even in the absence of is the true self. Beyond this, nothing more is to be known. And this I, which is present even in the absence, this can be accessed. A good God-given opportunity is there for the individual to experience this every day two times. One is before going to sleep, and one is the moment you wake up from the sleep. Deliberately go to sleep. Deliberately, not by default. If you deliberately and your attention is on the conscious principle, you can watch the mind going to sleep. Because it's not you who is going to sleep. Your identification with the mind, that I am the mind, is making you become dead to the world. All that is happening is mind is becoming empty of all thoughts of the world. Watch. If you have missed that, get up in the morning. Mind again wakes up. It's not you who is waking up, because you are identified with the mind. You say, I am awake. Thought comes, I am. Before many other thoughts of the world come in, you are there. Catch yourself. Be aware of the empty mind, that you are awake, but the mind is empty. So these two opportunities are every day being presented to us to recognize that this eternal I. The same Upanishad, Keno Upanishad, further states, if we are not able to discover our essential nature at this very moment, in this very place, in this very situation, we will never know. So don't collect this information and I will work on it when I get home. It will not happen. Right now, right here, remain absolutely alert about what is being talked about. The knowledge is now and here, never then and there. The more intensely one lives the consciousness that one is, to that extent relative perceptions drop away. This practice or abhyasa is called Savikalpa Samadhi. Savikalpa Samadhi is when all the thoughts, you are moving around in the world, but you are aware of the consciousness. That is Savikalpa Samadhi. Gradually, it will lead to Nirvikalpa Samadhi, a state where love ceases to be a verb and action to be done. Nirvikalpa Samadhi, where everything merges back into one. Just like you wake up in the morning and get involved in the world only to go back to sleep, isn't it? Where everything becomes unmanifest. Now imagine this whole thing is happening consciously. That you are moving around in this world, but your consciousness, conscious of the self. Then all that activity ceases to be, and yet you are conscious of the self. That is Nirvikalpa Samadhi. Love is a pure state of being in which there is neither acceptance nor denial, neither loss or gain. Everything is as it is. This is the Samvit Rahasya. And in this way, our Swami Anubhavananji, through unfolding these verses of Jnaneshwar Maharaj in Amrut Anubhav, is just beautiful. Even while talking, we are there. When we are explaining, we are there. Now let, for some time it's good, but it should become a default position for us, that we do not forget that we are that absolute being and not the relative one. And from the absolute standpoint, everything is as it is. The world is as it is. The body, the growth, the disease, decay, death, relationships, possessions, coming, going, everything is as it is. You don't complain about sunrise and sunset. You don't complain about the wind, the various seasons. Because you have accepted, this is how it is. Accept everything as it is, an expression of the divine, not inert, expression of the divine. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnahat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Maha Harihi.